Hello, my name is Paul Connett. I'm the Executive Director of the Fluoride Action Network. Earlier in 2018, I had a tour of New Zealand. I spoke in about five or six unfluoridated communities. And the object of my tour was to combat the proposal in the New Zealand Parliament to introduce mandatory fluoridation in New Zealand, into New Zealand, by default. They were advocating shifting the decision from the local communities to the district health boards. And since the district health boards traditionally follow the mandates of the Ministry of Health, this is essentially introducing mandatory fluoridation into New Zealand by default. I think the tour was very successful. We had large audiences, enthusiastic audiences, and my last presentation was actually in the New Zealand Parliamentary Building. Unfortunately, not one of these presentations was videotaped. And what we're doing today in San Francisco is to videotape my presentation as best as we can remember it with my PowerPoint presentation. So please imagine that whilst I'm talking, there are three members of Parliament in front of me, and that we have Mary Byrne and her husband Sean, who head up FAN New Zealand, and Stan Leitrus, a dentist, two lovely Maori women from Napier, and my wife Ellen listening to me. Can you imagine all that? Well, here goes. The title of my talk is "A Major US Government-Funded Brain Study Should End Fluoridation Worldwide." Let me introduce myself. I'm a retired professor of chemistry. I taught chemistry at St. Lawrence University in Canton, New York from 1983 to 2006. I specialized in environmental chemistry and toxicology. In July of 1996, my wife asked me to review the literature on the fluoridation debate. I didn't want this issue, but she's very persuasive. Here is a picture of Ellen, and she's in the audience. Ellen is the rock on which the Fluoride Action Network revolves. She is the secretary, she is the treasurer, she runs the web page, and she's into everything, but basically, she keeps us all going. I was the director of the Fluoride Action Network from 2000 to 2015, then I had a short break, and now I'm back to being director again in 2018. In 2010, I co-authored the book, The Case Against Fluoride, and two of the best decisions in my 20 years fighting fluoridation was choosing James Beck, MD, PhD, a retired professor from the University of Calgary, and Spedding Micklem, a retired professor of biology at Edinburgh University. Those were my two best choices, to choose those two co-authors who insisted that we understate everything and that everything should be documented. And I think all three of us thought that this book, when it came out, would raise the level of debate, that it would force the opponents to come back in kind, agree with some things perhaps and disagree with others, but we would have a much more precisely defined debate on fluoridation, at least on the scientific level. And I remember early on, after this book had been published, early on in 2011, I was invited to give a presentation to the Ministry of Health in Wellington. And about 20 people showed up, which was a surprise. They listened intently as I went through the message in the book. And at the end, I said, look, we three scientists, retired professor of physics, biology, and chemistry, we've done everything that we can to show the scientific arguments against fluoridation and back up everything up with citations from the literature, over 80 pages of references. I said, now it's your turn. This is your practice. This is your policy. Please choose one or two members of your staff to go through this book and destroy it. Respond to every argument. And quite frankly, if you can't do that, you should stop promoting fluoridation. Well, sadly, after, 8 years, nothing, nothing from the Ministry of Health in terms of responding to this book. Meanwhile, of course, they're pushing, trying to push mandatory fluoridation into New Zealand. Now, the outline of my talk. I will talk about this US government-funded study, which should end fluoridation. Then I shall explain that this study is just the tip of the iceberg as far as IQ studies are concerned. Then I will argue that using the public water supply to deliver any medicine, let alone fluoride, is a reckless thing to do. Then I shall talk about nature's guideline for babies as far as fluoride is concerned. And children are being overexposed to fluoride in fluoridated communities. I'll give the evidence for that. Six, in addition to the brain, fluoride can harm other tissues at low levels, and I shall talk about the evidence for that. Seven, the evidence that swallowing fluoride lowers tooth decay is extremely weak. The evidence is extremely weak. Eight, most countries don't fluoridate, yet their children's teeth have not suffered. And nine, I shall talk about why New Zealand should use the safer and cheaper ways of fighting tooth decay as promoted in Europe and particularly in Scotland. So here we go. Starting off with a quote from Arvid Carlsson. Arvid Carlsson is a pharmacologist. He won the Nobel Prize for Medicine in 2000. But in the 1970s, he led the successful campaign against fluoridation in Sweden. This is what he wrote then. This is what he wrote in 2010. Sweden rejected fluoridation in the 1970s. Our children have not suffered greater tooth decay. And in turn, our citizens have not borne the other hazards fluoride may cause. In any case, since fluoride is readily available in toothpaste, you don't have to force it on people. Arvid Carlsson. So here's the first part. US government-funded brain studies should end fluoridation worldwide. This came out in September of 2017. It was published in the journal Environmental Health Perspectives, which is one of the leading environmental health journals in the United States. This was a 12-year, multi-million dollar funded study. And it's striking which agencies funded it. The US National Institutes of Health, which is part of the National Institutes of Health, which promote fluoridation, the United States Department of Health and Human Services. The US National Institute of Environmental Health Sciences, which I think is one of the best scientific bodies in the United States, and also the US Environmental Protection Agency. In other words, it was funded by two agencies that have been very much involved in promoting fluoridation. And the authors. The authors came from many distinguished institutions, including Toronto, University of Toronto, Michigan, Indiana, McGill in Canada, Michigan again, Harvard, Mount Sinai, and Mexico City. And these researchers are highly qualified. Among them, they have produced over 50 papers, which have examined the cognitive health of children as related to environmental exposures to other neurotoxic substances like lead and mercury. So these researchers knew what they were doing. And the study was very rigorous. The authors carefully controlled for many potential confounding factors, including exposure to lead and mercury, socioeconomic status, smoking, alcohol use, and health problems during pregnancy. Very rigorous. And here's our website announcing this study in September of 2017. Fluoride exposure in utero linked to lower IQ in kids, new study says. Well, here's the details of the study. They examined over 300 mother-offspring pairs. And as far as the mothers were concerned, they measured their fluoride exposure by measuring their urine fluoride levels. And the levels in the urine are important because they measure total exposure. It doesn't matter whether the woman is exposed to fluoridated salt, fluoridated water, fluoridated toothpaste, whatever the source of fluoride, it doesn't matter in this study. It's reflected The level in the urine reflects total exposure, which is exactly what you need if you're going to compare communities with different sources of fluoride. As far as the children is concerned, they examine the IQ of those children at the age of 4 and again at ages between 6 and 12. And they're finding for every 1 milligram per liter increase in the mother's urine fluoride levels, the children lost an average of 5 to 6 IQ points. This is a very large and significant effect, which I shall be discussing more in detail later. Now, a 1 milligram liter difference in urine fluoride would be roughly the difference between living in a fluoridated area in the United States compared to a non-fluoridated area in the United States. So this study is very relevant to fluoridation in the United States and, of course, in New Zealand. Well, here's all their data. You see 300 data points here, mother-child pairs. On the left-hand axis, you have the IQ of the children, and down the bottom, the level of fluoride in the urine of the mothers. Now, you notice there's a very broad scatter of these data points, and some proponents of fluoridation have used that scatter to suggest that the contribution of fluoride is insignificant. Well, what you have to bear in mind is that there's a huge scatter of IQ based upon genetic difference. The genetic difference will explain a large amount of this scatter. And what we're looking at this curve is the influence that fluoride has on that scatter. If there was no influence from fluoride, then this would be a flat, straight line, a horizontal line. But that tilt is very significant. Now, Chris Neurath, our senior scientist at the Fluoride Action Network, has simplified this diagram to show that the range of fluoride levels in women in the United States would anticipate a loss of up to 6 IQ points. So the findings were highly statistically significant and were undiminished even after controlling for all those measured potential confounders. And for the testing at age 4, no lower threshold was found, down to the lowest maternal urine fluoride levels, measured 0.2, down to 0.2 parts per million. There's no evidence of a threshold. Now, as far as relating this to New Zealand, the levels of fluoride in these women from Mexico City are almost identical to the fluoride levels made in Palmerston North, a study by Brow and others. Almost identical range of exposure in Palmerston North. And quite frankly, the range of exposure do not have to be identical. It just happens to be identical in the case of Palmerston. But just being in the same ballpark is a reason for concern. There is a copy of the abstract of this paper presented at a conference in New Zealand in 2015. So we could adjust Chris Neurath's graphs as follows with the same interval, essentially, that you have in New Zealand, the same fluoride interval that you have in New Zealand between the fluoridated women living in fluoridated communities versus non-fluoridated communities. So what was the American Dental Association, one of the leading promoters of fluoridation in the United States and worldwide, what was their response to this? Within a few minutes of the paper being published, they'd obviously got advance warning, the American Dental Association came out with a statement and said as follows: the ADA has examined a study in environmental health perspectives based on fluoride intake in Mexico and concludes the findings are not applicable to the United States. The ADA continues to endorse fluoridation of public water as the most effective public health measure to prevent tooth decay. Well, in a way, we've got used to these kind of statements from the ADA. I think they work backwards. Any study that finds harm is a junk study or not relevant, blah, blah, blah. They've always got a series of excuses. But what's interesting, in the same newspaper where this quote was published in Canada, this is the response from the lead investigator of that study, Dr. Howard Hugh from the University of Toronto. He says, "This is a very rigorous epidemiology study. You just can't deny it. It is directly related to whether fluoride is a risk for the neurodevelopment of children. To say it has no relevance to the folks in the United States seems disingenuous." Yes, indeed. So that brings me to part two. This Bashash study doesn't come out all by itself. It comes out after we've had a very, very large number of studies involving fluoride and children's IQ, and I'd like to summarize some of those studies now. Since 1991, when I first started, I started in 95, but before I started, since 1991, there have been 59 IQ studies from China, India, Iran, Mexico, and New Zealand, and 52 of them have shown lower IQ among children in high fluoride villages compared to low fluoride villages. In most cases, that fluoride exposure was from naturally occurring fluoride in the water. In 2012, a team from Harvard University, headed up by Choi, and in including Philippe Grandjean, who's one of the world's experts on mercury's neurotoxicity, published a meta-analysis of 27 of these IQ studies. Again, this was published in Environmental Health Perspectives. The Harvard team acknowledged what most people have acknowledged, that there were many weaknesses in these studies. They didn't have all the information we would have liked. It wasn't clear that all the studies had controlled for all the confounding variables. But some did, particularly the Zhang study, which I should talk about more in a moment. However, what the authors, what the Choi and others stressed, is that results were remarkably consistent. Even though these 27 studies were done over a period of about 20 years and done in two different countries, in this case China and Iran, and in many different geographical areas in China, by different research teams, they've had a remarkable consistency of results. In 26 of the 27 studies, the children in the high fluoride exposure villages had a lower IQ than the children in the low fluoride villages. And the average lowering was a very significant 7 IQ points. Now, fluoridation proponents have argued that the concentrations in the high fluoride villages were not relevant to water fluoridation in the United States. They are wrong. Here is a table of 20 of those studies, and the average fluoride concentration of these 20 studies is 3.52 parts per million, which is actually lower than the current safe drinking water standard in the United States. Now, to put those numbers on that table into perspective, New Zealand is fluoridated on average at 0.85 parts per million. These levels in which lowering of IQ have occurred are far too close for comfort. And also, when you try to claim, as they do, that the comparing the concentration of fluoridation in artificial fluoridation, which in the United States is now 0.7 parts per million, to these concentrations, they're making a very serious mistake. You can't it doesn't make sense to compare concentrations. What you should be comparing is doses. Compare the dose where you find harm with the dose, the range of doses that you're likely to get in a fluoridated community. Concentration is milligrams per liter. Dose is milligrams per day. And so it's determined by two things. One, how much water you drink, and two, how much fluoride you get from other sources. If you're fluoridated at 1 milligram per liter, if you drink 1 liter, you're going to get 1 milligram per day. If you drink 2 liters a day, you're going to get 2 milligrams per day. So what we should be looking at is dose, total dose from all sources. And again, let me stress, dose depends on how much water you drink. So a child drinking, say, a high water consumer drinking 0.85 milligrams per liter, as in New Zealand, could get more fluoride than a low water consumer at 2 milligrams per liter. Total dose then depends on all sources of fluoride, in dental products, tea, pesticide residues, and so on. And there's something else we ought to introduce, especially when we get into talking about effects in children, and especially young children, and now the fetus, is the dosage. And what the dosage does is to control for body weight. You notice, I think everybody knows, that a safe dose of aspirin for an adult is many, many times higher than the safe dose for an infant. And the way we adjust for that age difference, is the weight difference. So you take the dose and divide by the body weight in kilograms to get a term called dosage. So a same dose in milligrams per day will have a greater toxic effect on a 4 kilogram baby than on a 20 kilogram child, and even greater effect on the fetus. So that we have to add in that when we're comparing what causes harm in a study group and what could cause harm in a fluoridated community. Now, in 2014, two very distinguished scientists in New Zealand came out with a report which has been used very widely in New Zealand to promote this notion of introducing mandatory fluoridation in New Zealand. It's called The Health Effects of Water Fluoridation, A Review of the Scientific Evidence. The two scientists, Peter Gluckman, Sir Peter Gluckman, Chief Advisor to the Prime Minister of New Zealand, and Sir David Skegg, Head of the Royal Society of New Zealand. Highly distinguished scientists. But as far as reviewing the scientific evidence, this study can only be called junk science. It's very, very weak indeed. And let me give you a couple of examples. This is what they said about those 27 studies. They said the fluoride exposures in these studies were many, up to 20 times higher than any that are experienced in New Zealand or other community water fluoridation communities. In other words, they're making that same fundamental mistake of confusing concentration with dose. If you're going to compare communities where a harm is caused in your own community, you've got to look at doses. And here I've highlighted the two places where the levels get up to anything close to 20 times the fluoride concentration in artificial water fluoridation. Two. Now, there's another important thing that Gluckman and Skegg should know very well. When you've got a list of studies and you're trying to see what's relevant for protecting your community or your country, you don't look at the highest doses which have caused harm, or in this case, the highest concentrations called harm that causes harm. You go to the lowest concentrations that cause harm. And similarly, you don't go to the weakest studies that have caused harm, but you go to the strongest studies that cause harm, and they did neither. So I'd like to turn now to one of those studies in the 27. It's a study by Zhang from 2003. I've met Zhang. We brought him over to the United States to talk at a fan conference. And I went to the two villages where this study was done. In one village, the low fluoride village, the average fluoride in the well water was 0.36 parts per million. There's a range there. This is naturally occurring fluoride in their well water. And the high fluoride village, again, a big range, but the average was 2.5 parts per million. Notice that 0.36 is less than you have added in New Zealand, and 2.5 is more, but you're in between. This study covered a range which covers New Zealand. Now, they controlled for lead exposure and iodine intake, very important, and retrospectively for arsenic. So a good study. And they found a drop of 5 to 10 IQ points across the whole age range between the two villages. You see this in the graph here. The black line is the low fluoride village. The dotted magenta line is the high fluoride village, and you see how the fluoride has shifted the whole IQ curve over, which means you've got far fewer highly intelligent children and more mentally handicapped children. And they don't like to use that word mentally handicapped in New Zealand. I think I've got a better definition of what this means when you have an IQ less than 70. In the United States, we say mentally handicapped. In New Zealand, they say something else. But Zhang did something extremely important. He subdivided the high fluoride village, Waimea, into five different subgroups of ascending fluoride concentrations. So you look at those groups in this table, A, B, C, D, E. You see how the concentration ranges at the bottom from 0.75 parts per million up to 4.16 parts per million with concentrations in between. So a range of concentrations, and now in the blue box, you'll see the mean IQ in those five subgroups going from 99.56 down to 78.38. And you've got here what always strengthens an epidemiological study, and that is a dose response, a dose response. In this case, a dose response between the concentration of fluoride in the water and the average IQ of the children. And here it is plotted. The IQ on the left-hand axis, the bottom axis, the level of fluoride in the water. So what this line suggests, at minimum, there's a drop of IQ in this study between 0.75 parts per million and 1.5 parts per million. And remember, the average in New Zealand is 0.85 parts per million. So even before you've applied any safety factor, we have a serious problem here as far as New Zealand's children is concerned, if this study is valid, if this study is good, if there's no unforeseen conflicting variable that they didn't account for. Now, a colleague of mine, Dr. Bill Hersey, a former scientist at the EPA, and several others, including Zhang, did an analysis to quantify where, at what level, what dose the IQ would be lowered. Hitherto, we've only talked about concentration. Now we're turning to dose. This is a picture on the left-hand side. You see Zhang. There's me, Chris Neurath, our senior science director, and Bill Hersey, a former senior scientist at the EPA who specialized in risk assessment. So he took his specialty and applied it to Zhang's data. And without going into the technique here, look at the red arrow. That red arrow indicates the level, based upon this study, at which IQ is lowered by 5 IQ points. So if we look at the red arrow, this is saying 1.4 milligrams per day in this study lowered the IQ by 5 IQ points in this study. A dose of 1.4 milligrams per day lowers IQ in the Zhang study by 5 IQ points. Now, again, relating this to New Zealand, here is the estimated dietary fluoride intake for New Zealand, a study prepared for the Ministry of Health by these authors. And what you see is that for 5 to 6-year-olds and 7 to 10-year-old children, their dietary intake from water, from fluoridated water, is 0.84 to 0.99 milligrams per day. So we're worried about 1.4 milligrams. They're getting it from fluoridated, half of it, at least half of it, from fluoridated water. And the same study, this is the in red, is the level that they can get from toothpaste, fluoridated toothpaste. Between the two of them, you can see that many children in New Zealand would exceed this 1.4 milligrams per day, which would lower IQ by 5 IQ points based upon that Zhang study. Now I wanted to explain why a loss of 5 IQ points is so serious at the population level. For some individuals, it would be very serious at the individual level if you're trying to get into a university or trying to get the top job somewhere. Those five IQ points could make all the difference. But it's the devastating impact of what we're finding here is what it does to the whole population. So this diagram here shows a normal distribution of IQ, this so-called bell-shaped curve. This applies to any human trait. This is a very rough curve, but it gives you the general idea. Basically, most people, according to this curve, would cluster around an average IQ. Most people in your population would cluster around an average IQ of 100 IQ points. But look at the two tails. That green area on the right is the fraction of the total where you have very bright children. These are children with an IQ above 130. As you go further and further to the right, you're getting into the genius level. That's the fraction of those children. And over on the left, the magenta area is the fraction of the children who are intellectually impaired, an IQ of less than 80. And here is the definition to avoid saying the wrong things. Quote, an IQ of 70 is a level of intellectual impairment at the threshold of warranting institutionalization, or possibly under current New Zealand disability policy, intensively supported non-institutional living. Now, if we were to shift the IQ of the whole population down by five, and unfortunately, this is what water fluoridation poses, you're doing something to the whole population. You are exposing the whole population to a toxic substance. You're exposing the whole population to probably a neurotoxic substance when you put fluoride in the water. Well, if we shifted that curve over, the average would go from 100 to 95. And quite frankly, a parent would not notice the difference between two children, two siblings, one with an IQ of 100, one with 95, nor would a school teacher. You'd have to do tests to tease that out. But look what happens to the two tails of the curve. You literally halve the number of very bright children. That blue shaded area here is the fraction now which are very bright, and you see that the area from previously has gone down. And over on the left-hand side, you'll see that the fraction that is intellectually impaired has gone up. Now, that has huge ramifications for any modern industrialized society fighting for the global economy to make things go, to drop, to halve the number of very bright, the number of geniuses in your society, obviously has serious, serious ramifications on the economic level, and increasing the number of mentally handicapped children that need mentally, intellectually impaired children obviously has huge economic costs and social costs for your country. And if you have any idea that a substance out there in commerce is doing this, you quickly get it out of the marketplace. We took lead out of paint. We took lead out of gasoline because this is what we eventually found that lead was doing. But in our case, in the case of fluoridation, this is something that we're deliberately doing. We're deliberately adding this to the water supply. So we don't have to lobby the oil industry or the gasoline industry or the lead industry. We simply have to stop adding this fluoride to the drinking water. Now, this is what Gluckman and Skegg said about the Chinese studies. All of this, by the way, is so important to understand because it was these kind of arguments which they have been using for over 20 years now to keep scientists and public health people away from all the studies that we've been revealing on our webpage, on our database. Okay, Klugman and Skegg say, recently there have been a number of reports from China and other areas that have claimed an association between high water fluoride levels and minimally reduced intelligence, measured as IQ in children. They go on. The claim shift of less than one IQ point suggests that this is likely to be a measurement or statistical artifact of no functional significance. Ding, 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 ding. less than one IQ point? No, it wasn't less than one IQ point. It was less than, there was seven IQ points in these studies that he's referring to. So Gluckman and Skegg were incorrect. What they've done is to confuse a drop of half a standard deviation, and half a standard deviation is seven IQ points, with half an IQ point. So they thought that the loss was only half an IQ point, and they were wrong. And in 2014, they should have cleared up this. I mean, we knew early on that the promoters were using this confusion to say there was no problem, but surely by 2014, Gluckman and Skegg could have sorted this out. Anyway, they produced a corrected version. When Fan New Zealand pointed out this terrible mistake, they made a change. And this is what they did in the corrected version. They said the claim shift of less than one standard deviation suggests that this is likely to be a measurement or statistical artifact of no functional significance. Now, there's two terrible things wrong with this. Number one, very few people in New Zealand, I think, and most countries, would know what a standard deviation is for an IQ curve. They wouldn't know that what they're talking about, the standard deviation, is 14 IQ points, so less than one standard deviation. And the other thing which is outrageous, by not communicating clearly what their mistake was, they allowed their conclusion to continue unchecked, if you like, in the minds of the readers. Their conclusion doesn't make sense when they say that it conflicts with the premise. Look, look at their conclusion. When they first said it, less than one IQ point, this is likely to be a measurement or statistical artifact of no functional significance. Then they change it to less than one standard deviation. That's right. But then they continue with the same conclusion, even though they've changed the premise of the sentence, is that this is likely to be a measurement or statistical artifact of no functional significance. Absolute nonsense. So here's what here's the corrected version of their corrected version. They should have written, the claim shift of seven IQ points suggests that this is likely to be a measurement or statistical artifact of no functional significance. Absolute nonsense, of course, as you've just seen. A drop of five IQ points is highly significant. Significant as far as functioning in a modern industrialized society. So changing the shift from less than one IQ point to seven IQ points makes this conclusion preposterous. And here again is the graph. This is what they're saying has no functional significance. And of course, it's just not true. And again, this review by Gluckman and Skegg for many New Zealand journalists and editors and politicians was the final word in settling this issue of fluoride's neurotoxicity. On the individual level, the last children in society who need their IQ lowered are children from low-income families, who are precisely those being targeted for fluoridation. In other words, the children we are trying to help are going to be hurt most. A classic example of good intentions. I'm sure many of the people that supported the introduction of fluoridation had very good intentions, but clearly this has gone awry now that we know that children could lose IQ points. And again, the last children who need to lose IQ points are those being targeted by fluoridation. Now, proponents of fluoridation have only offered one human study that they say negates all the other human studies that are found of lowering IQ associated with fluoride exposure. And that was a study done in Dunedin by Broadbent and others and published in 2015. But the Broadbent study is fatally flawed. They had very few children in their controls. They had 991 children living in fluoridated areas, in the fluoridated area, and only 99 in the non-fluoridated area. And Broadbent did not use the proper measure of fluoride exposure. He should have looked at total fluoride exposure. Instead, they only looked at exposure from fluoridated water. In New Zealand during the 70s, when the study children were young, fluoride supplements were often prescribed to those living in non-fluoridated areas. And Broadbent should have taken that into account. And when others have looked at his data and estimated total fluoride intakes, they found that there was very little difference in the total fluoride intake for his subjects and the controls when you take the fluoride supplements into account. And those letters were published in the same journal as Broadbent's PLACES study. The study, in short, had insufficient power to detect any effect. And it's not surprising that it found no difference in IQ. And to use this as a broad brush to dismiss all the studies done in China, India, Iran, and Mexico is a gigantic act of irresponsibility in my mind. And now I'm going to turn to more common sense arguments against water fluoridation, starting with the use using the public water supply to deliver any medicine. And we've never done it with any other medicine since fluoridation began. Using the public water supply to deliver any medicine is a reckless thing to do. Let me explain. In addition to depriving millions of people of their right to informed consent to medicine, it's very, very, very reckless, because when you add a substance to the water supply, you expose the whole population to a toxic substance. This takes no account of the fact that some people will be far more sensitive to fluoride's toxicity than others. And it's reckless to add a known toxic substance to the public water, drinking water, with no control over dose. But people can drink huge amounts of water. And you ask any pharmacist, you've got to be able to control the dose of any medicine. Every tube of medicine, those tablets, you're told how many tablets to take a day, what the milligrams are, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And to make matters even worse, the fluoride used is not pharmaceutical grade fluoride as in toothpaste, but a hazardous waste product from the phosphate fertilizer industry. Now, the level used in New Zealand is 0.85 parts per million on average. 0.85 parts per million might seem a low concentration, but in reality, it is 170 to 850 times the level in mother's milk in New Zealand. And it's reckless to expose bottle-fed babies to hundreds of times more fluoride than nature intended. So what we're doing is we're ignoring nature's guideline for newborn babies, if you like. The range of fluoride levels in mother's milk in New Zealand is from 0.001 to 0.005 parts per million, and that gives rise to what I've just said. With the average fluoride level in New Zealand at 0.85 parts per million, a bottle-fed baby where the mother uses formula and makes it up with a solid formula, makes it up with fluoridated tap water, she's going to be giving her baby 170 to 850 times the level in New Zealand's mother's milk. And this is about going back to Arvid Carlson, remember him? One wonders what an increase in the exposure to fluoride, such as occurs in bottle-fed infants, may mean for the development of the brain and the other organs. Now, that was a statement he made in 1978. It helped to stop fluoridation in Sweden, and he was way ahead of his time in pointing out this potential impact on the brain. So it brings me to part five, the evidence that children in fluoridated communities are being overexposed to fluoride. And this is We can say that because when they started fluoridation in 1945 in the United States, they thought that a certain number of children would get dental fluorosis, which is a mottling of the enamel, discoloration of the enamel, which was well known. It was well known in the 1930s that fluoride caused this condition, and that's when they called it dental fluorosis. But in 1945, they thought they could limit the number of children that would get this mottling discoloration of the teeth to about 10, maybe 15% of the population, and only in its very mild form. But if you look at this graph here, this is from the Center of Disease Control in 2010. You see that in total, 41% of children age 12 to 15 had this condition, and not only in the very mild, but in this case, 8.6% in the mild category, where 50% of the enamel is impacted. Now, in New Zealand, you've got these figures. 44.5% of 8 to 30-year-olds had some dental fluorosis, with the majority of the fluorosis being questionable or very mild. They then give the numbers for moderate dental fluorosis and severe dental fluorosis, but notice they leave out mild dental fluorosis, which can impact up to 50% of the tooth surface, and that is what many teenagers find very objectionable from a psychological point of view when they're trying to get dates and so on. But to me, the issue is not so much what health concerns there are about dental fluorosis, but the reckless assumption that when fluoride is doing this to the growing tooth cells, ignoring what it might be doing to the rest of the body, to the other tissues. And that's the issue that Carlson raises. So let's have a look at the other potential harm. In addition to the brain, fluoride harms many other tissues. And the reason we know that is there's a very important review published in 2006 by the National Research Council. It's called Fluoride in Drinking Water, a Scientific Review of EPA's Standards. Now, the US EPA paid the National Research Council to do this review because they were trying to determine if they needed to lower the so-called safe drinking water standard in the United States, which is set at a ridiculously high level, 4 parts per million. In Canada, it's 1.5 parts per million. In Mexico, it's 1.5 parts per million. The World Health Organization says the safe level, or the dangerous level, is above 1.5. They found this panel of 12 experts, 3 were pro-fluoridation, 3 were anti-fluoridation, 6 were undeclared. So it was the first balanced panel in the United States history that had looked at the toxicity of fluoride. And they concluded that fluoride damages teeth, dental fluorosis, fluoride damages bones, causing a condition called skeletal fluorosis. In places in India and China, you see dental fluorosis in the kids, and you see skeletal fluorosis in the adults. And the first symptoms of skeletal fluorosis is just like arthritis. Fluoride is an endocrine disruptor. It lowers thyroid function and accumulates in the human pineal gland. And as we've seen, fluoride damages the brain. Now, notice what we've said here is fluoride does all these things. No question that fluoride harms nearly every tissue in the body. No question about that. But the real question is, does fluoridation cause this harm? Do with the relatively low levels that we have exposure that we get in artificial fluoridated communities, can it cause any of these harms? Well, I've already been through the brain, but this is what the National Research Council said about this in 2006, and they only had 5 IQ studies published at that time. It is apparent that fluorides have the ability to interfere with functions of the brain. So, with all these other health risks on the table, and I won't go into any more details, I think it's sufficient. If it's true that fluoride damages the brain, if it's true that fluoride at the levels of fluoridated communities can lower IQ in children, to me, the argument is over. How could anybody accept a trade-off between lowering your kid's IQ versus lowering the kid's tooth decay? Obviously, the brain is far more important than the teeth. And that argument becomes stronger when you find that there are better alternatives to fluoridation, which we will come to in a moment. But first of all, the evidence that swallowing fluoride lowers tooth decay is actually extremely weak. You know, when I first got involved with this in 1996, I thought the issue would be whether fluoride causes harm, but I assumed that because everybody wanted this practice from all the professional bodies and the government health agencies and so on, that the fact that it would lower tooth decay by swallowing fluoride would be pretty clear cut. In fact, the evidence is extremely weak. This is what one reviewer said in 1999, David Locker, and he, in a review which he conducted for Ontario Ministry of Health, the magnitude of fluoridation's effect, it means benefit, is not large in absolute terms, is often not statistically significant, and may not be of clinical significance. In 2000, the York Review in England reported that they could find no grade A studies supporting the efficacy of fluoridation for fighting tooth decay. What do they mean by grade A studies? They mean randomized control trials, RCTs, the gold standard for epidemiological studies, a randomized control trial. It would be difficult to do that on a community level, but it would be easy to do that, and they do it for every drug that comes on the market at the individual level. Some individuals randomly selected would get the fluoride, and some individuals randomly selected would get the placebo. And after 70 years, they've never done such a randomized controlled trial for water fluoridation. In 2015, the Cochrane collaboration, which again is the gold standard as far as assessing the validity of medical, the science on medical issues, they're acknowledged as the gold standard in these kind of reviews. They looked at the evidence that fluoridation reduced tooth decay and concluded they could find no high-quality research that showed that fluoridation provided any benefit to adults, that fluoridation provided additional benefits over and above topically applied fluoride, that fluoridation did not, and there were no high-quality studies indicating that it reduced inequalities among children from different socioeconomic groups, or that when you stop fluoridation, tooth decay went up. No high-quality studies to demonstrate all those things which promoters claim nearly every day. They did concede that there were some studies which showed that water fluoridation reduced tooth decay in children, but said that they question whether these studies, which were from quite a while ago, from the 1940s to the 60s, were relevant to today. They reckoned that they had a high risk of bias in those days when the issue was promoting fluoridation, and they were conducted prior to the availability of fluoride toothpaste. Not exactly a glowing report to justify fluoridation, the effectiveness of fluoridation. Certainly not enough to justify risking our children's brains. Now, going to the United States, the largest survey of dental fluorosis and dental caries in the United States was carried out in 1986-87 by the U.S. National Institute for Dental Research, which was one of the big promoters of fluoridation again. They collected dental fluorosis and dental caries data for 39,000 children from 84 communities. And this is, when you see the results, it's a story of two relationships. One relationship is very strong, and one is very weak. So here, on the left-hand side, in the green box, is the communities that are being examined for these statistics. There were those with fluoride less than 0.3, those who had fluoride levels between 0.3 and 0.7 milligrams per liter, those that were fluoridated artificially, that's between 0.7 and 1.2, and those above 1.2. So three of those categories are naturally occurring fluoride, and the third one is for artificial fluoridation. Well, here are the percentage of the children with dental fluorosis in this very large survey. You see that the percentage of children with dental fluorosis increases remarkably as the level of concentration in their drinking water goes up. 14.6, 19.6, 25, and 40%. On the other hand, what about the children with caries as those concentrations go up? Practically no change, 55.5, 54.6, 54.4, 56.4. So clearly you have one relationship which is very strong. As fluoride goes up in the drinking water, dental fluorosis goes up. The number of kids with dental fluorosis goes up. But as fluoride goes up in the drinking water, you don't see much difference in the percentage of kids with dental fluorosis. And similarly, in New Zealand, these statistics are gathered by New Zealand School Dental Statistics in 2016, show no difference in 2016 in five-year-olds between those living in a fluoridated and those living in non-fluoridated communities. Most countries don't fluoridate their water, but their children's teeth have not suffered. The vast majority of countries worldwide do not fluoridate their water, including 97% of Europe. Some of them fluoridate their salt, but not many. But their teeth are no worse than those that do. Here's statistics. These graphs here, again drawn up by Chris Neurath, were based upon data online from the World Health Organization. They represent tooth decay in 12-year-olds from the 1960s right the way through to the 2000s. And you can see that tooth decay is coming down in the, I think it's 14 countries which are non-fluoridated, as the fluoridated communities, there are four of those countries. There's practically no difference. If anything, the tooth decay rates are coming down faster in the non-fluoridated countries than the fluoridated ones. And if you look at the dates between 2000 and 2005, there's very little difference in tooth decay in 12-year-olds, whether they've grown up in a fluoridated or a non-fluoridated community. The probable explanation for the lack of difference in tooth decay is the mechanism of fluoride's action on the teeth. This is what the CDC stated in 1999. They said, laboratory and epidemiologic research suggests that fluoride prevents dental caries predominantly after eruption of the tooth into the mouth, and its actions are primarily topical. So what they said in 1999 was essentially, we've been wrong about the mechanism for 50 years. And really, in my view, this should have, when they admitted this, it should have spelt the end of water fluoridation. And by the way, your own Robin Wyman from New Zealand, a prominent promoter of fluoridation, agrees with this. He says it is generally accepted that the principal carrier's protective effect from fluoride is topical. As I say, he's highly influential in this debate on fluoridation in New Zealand, but he accepts this statement that fluoridation works mainly topically. Now, I ask you, this is common sense. If fluoride works primarily on the outside of the tooth and the teeth are readily available to you, why swallow it? Why expose the whole body to this toxic substance when you can limit your exposure to the teeth and maybe a little that goes through the gums, but you can control it to a large extent? And why put it in the drinking water and force it on people who don't want it? So you can solve the scientific problems, the health issues, and you can solve the primary ethical problem of forcing it on people that don't want it just by changing the delivery system. Instead of putting fluoride in the water, find ways to encourage, particularly children from low-income families, to brush their teeth with fluoridated toothpaste. And why force this unpopular practice on the remaining unfluoridated communities in New Zealand, which is over half the communities right now in New Zealand don't want fluoridation, don't have fluoridation, and many of them have fought very hard over many years to keep it out. So this brings us to part 8. New Zealand should use the safer and cheaper ways of fighting tooth decay as practiced in Europe, and particularly in Scotland. Scotland has the Child Smile program. It's a very straightforward program. They teach tooth brushing in nursery schools. The first school that the kid goes to, they're taught how to brush their teeth. They do it in class all together. The teacher supervises. They provide healthy snacks and drinks in the schools. They've yanked out the soft drinks with all that sugar in it. And they involve the parents. The parents are involved in this dental hygiene, better diet, reducing sugar impact input. And also they provide annual dental checkups and give treatment if required, including fluoride varnish applications. Now, what's remarkable is that FAN New Zealand has actually compared the statistics on four levels between New Zealand and Scotland. And Scotland, with this simple program, is doing better than New Zealand on every category. So here's the average number of dental fillings per child age 6. In New Zealand, 1.88. In Scotland, 1.27. Number of fillings per child, year 8. New Zealand, 1.14. Scotland, 0.6. The children with completely healthy teeth, Scotland 68%, New Zealand 57%. And year eight, children with completely healthy teeth, 73% in Scotland with no fluoridation, and 54% in New Zealand. So on all these four categories, Scotland has overtaken New Zealand with this program, starting in 2000, the so-called Child Smile program. Now, in addition to that, it's cost-effective. Glasgow research has found that they reduced the cost of treating dental disease in five-year-olds by more than half between 2001 and 2010. And part of that large cost savings, in my view, is that they have reduced the incidence of baby bottle tooth decay because they have access to the parents. They can tell the parents of the scourge of baby bottle tooth decay. And this baby bottle tooth decay is what often leads to extractions in young children under 5 under general anesthetic, which is traumatic and very expensive. So, overall, our kids need more brushing, more fruit and vegetables, less sugar. Less sugar means less tooth decay and less obesity. Less obesity means less diabetes and fewer heart attacks. In other words, education to promote less sugar consumption is a very good investment. And now let's look, we need education, not fluoridation, to fight tooth decay and obesity. And I want to say a few more words about baby bottle tooth decay. This is a condition caused by babies sucking on bottles of fruit juice, sugared water, milk, or even Coca-Cola for an hours on end. And what it does is it rots the milk teeth, the first teeth, to the gums, the top teeth to the gums, but hardly touches the bottom teeth. Here you see a picture of baby bottle tooth decay. You can see the top teeth are absolutely awful. These are the teeth that have to get extracted under anesthesia. But the bottom teeth, because the baby's tongue, when they're sipping on these sippy bottles, protects the bottom teeth. So you can easily tell when you've got baby bottle tooth decay. But around the fluoridating world, it hasn't stopped health officers trying to persuade communities if they don't fluoridate their water, they're going to get more of these dreadful conditions. But the fact is that there is no difference in the prevalence of baby bottle tooth decay between fluoridated and non-fluoridated communities. Where the difference is between high fluoride areas, high income areas and low income areas. It's access to the parents which can reduce the incidence of baby bottle tooth decay, which is precisely what you get if you put an emphasis on education, not fluoridation. Here in this picture, you see a medical officer of health from Canada holding up a picture of what is obviously baby bottle tooth decay, and yet she's indicating to the audience that this is what you get if you don't have fluoridation, which is absolute poppycock. And civil servants should not be in the business of spinning evidence like this. And the same misuse of data on baby bottle tooth decay is being used in New Zealand, claiming that the difference in general anesthetic extractions is higher in non-fluoridated communities, in fluoridated communities, which is not the case. Here is an example from Taranaki. The claim that this is happening this is a complaint from a district health board in Taranaki. Quote, the rot is already starting to show on young children's teeth since the removal of fluoride from New Plymouth water, a local dentist says. There's a huge impact on children's dental health, but he is looking, the figures quoted here, district health board had referred 10 two-year-olds to get teeth removed under anesthetic. Now look at the numbers. This is Taranaki. The fluoridated area, the total number of general anesthetic surgeries, 34 out of a population of 11,600. Non-fluoridated New Plymouth, that this dental district health board is complaining about, only 7 extractions under general anesthesia from 74,000 people. So a difference between a percentage of 16.35 general anesthetic extractions in the fluoridated community versus less than 1% in the non-fluoridated Plymouth. Again, spinning from civil servants to keep this practice alive. And these kind of tactics would not be necessary if science was on the promoter's side, but it is not. That is why after 8 years, there has been no detailed or documented response to our book, The Case Against Fluoride, as I mentioned in the beginning. Here's that book again. So summarizing, fluoridation is unusual. Most countries don't do it. It is unnatural. The level of fluoride in mother's milk is extremely low. It is unethical. It violates the individual's right to informed consent to medical treatment. It is unsafe. There are many health concerns, not least of which is the lowering of IQ in our children. Unprotective of the unborn child and the bottle-fed infant. And it is ineffective. The evidence of benefit is very weak and unnecessary. There are better ways of fighting tooth decay, as we've seen in the Child Smile program in Scotland. So conclusions, water fluoridation is an obsolete practice, and it's time to end it in New Zealand. No government should be deliberately adding a neurotoxic, brain-damaging substance to the public water supply. I would recommend that you either immediately stop fluoridation in order to protect your most precious resource, and here is a picture of your most precious resource here in New Zealand. It is your young children. Or, if you don't want to have a direct outright ban, have a 5-year moratorium. While scientists confirm or refute the fact that fluoride lowers IQ at current exposure levels in fluoridated communities, and New Zealand puts in place a Child Smile program throughout the country while continually to carefully monitor tooth decay. A 5-year moratorium. At the very least, MPs should oppose the bill that would make fluoridation mandatory and leave the decision where it is at the moment with local communities. If we're going to make mistakes, let's make sure those are democratic mistakes and not bureaucratic mistakes. Resources, you have the National Research Council report, very important. That's available online for free. You have our book and you have our webpage, fluoridealert.org. It's the largest health database on fluoride in the world. Click on researchers. It has many, many videos, and those number of videos are increasing. And if you go to our webpage, there's two places to look for. Top right-hand corner, you have the name, the word researchers. Click on that to get the health database. And you also have on the left-hand side in the middle, Fan TV. Click on that and you get a host of very useful videotapes. And with that, I thank you all very much for listening, and I'll say goodbye.